Over the next few months, we're going to be producing a series of videos on the history of computer animation. In the last video, we saw the ways early innovators used computers for expression, and how Hollywood first embraced computer-generated special effects. In this video, we will step away from the abstract towards the adorable and the terrifying, as advancements in technology make fully computer-animated narratives a reality. Since the 1920s, animation had largely been defined by American cartoons. Many of the characters featured in these films became beloved pieces of pulp culture, with some even eclipsing their creators, becoming part of the national identity. With the technological limitations of early computing, artists cannot render anthropomorphic figures, instead relying on abstract imagery. By the early 1980s, graphic interfaces had advanced to the point where humans and computers could collaborate with relative ease. In 1984, Eddie Garrick produced The Magic Egg, a computer odyssey. Intended for IMAX, The Magic Egg has been described as a computer graphics fantasia. It was an audiovisual experience created entirely on computer, featuring synthesizers and animation commissioned from artisan research labs. Contributors included John Whitney, who we discussed at length in Part 1, as well as the Computer Graphics Lab at the New York Institute of Technology. At the time, NYIT was the top computer animation research facility in the world. It had been founded with the purpose of not only simplifying the animation process, but of taking the medium in new directions. In 1979, the lab began production on what I hope would be the first fully computer-animated narrative film titled The Works. Written by researcher Lance Williams, The Works was to be a futuristic sci-fi story following a charming robot and a pilot in their battle with a supercomputer who was taken over Earth. The project progressed slowly. The staff at NYIT were constantly developing new technology in order to keep up with their vision, and resources were diverted to commercial projects to fund the ambitious film. Despite having the most powerful computers available, it still would have taken 7 years to generate enough images needed for the planned 90-minute runtime. In total, 10 minutes of footage and designs were produced before the works was abandoned in 1986. NYIT's goal of creating the first computer-animated narrative would eventually be achieved in Montreal, Quebec, by a group of professors at the University of Montreal. Nadia Magané Tallman, Philip Bergeron, and Daniel Tallman had been experimenting with 3D modeling, specifically 3D character modeling. In 1982, they produced the animated short Dream Flight. This featured an alien dreaming of flying through space and arriving on Earth, exploring the natural world as well as Paris and New York. Bergeron would collaborate with Pierre LaChapelle, Daniel Langlois, and Pierre Robidoux for the landmark short, Tony de Peltrie. Finished in 1985, Tony de Peltrie tells the story of a faded piano player recalling his past glory. Tony was the first computer-animated human to convey emotion through facial expressions and mannerisms. While he very much falls into the uncanny valley, we as an audience are still able to feel his melancholy and his joy. In 1987, Nadi and Daniel produced Rendez-vous in Montreal, in which Humphrey Bogart and Marilyn Monroe agreed to come back from the dead, meeting at a Montreal cafe. This marked the first time a deceased actor's likeness had been digitally reproduced, an effect accomplished by mapping out polygons on sculptures of the actors and creating a 3D model. While I think the plot of this film is absurd, the concepts it introduces are terrifying. The idea that actors, or anyone for that matter, could be emulated on film or video posthumously, or not even, brings up all sorts of legal and ethical questions. More on that in the next video. Montreal was on fire in the 1980s, not only with incredible creative output, but also technological innovation. Every one of these films feels years ahead of its time, each in a very different way, but one of the most influential developments came from Tony de Peltrie co-director Daniel Langlois. In 1986, he founded the company SoftImage and began working on a program that would allow artists to model, animate, or render 3D images specifically for animation. The result? SoftImage 3D became the industry standard, and was used not only to create fully 3D environments, but also video game graphics as well as special effects. It was adopted by George Lucas's Industrial Light and Magic, who had revolutionized CGI in the late 1970s. In 1979, Lucas had pushed the top talent in the field of computer graphics to establish a department within ILM dedicated to creating computer-generated effects. The graphics group, as it was known, was headed by Edwin Catmull. As we covered in the last video, Catmull had been on the forefront of computer animation throughout the 1970s. He had been working at NYIT and on the works when he was approached by Lucas, and along with Alvin Ray Smith had made several breakthroughs there, most notably Alpha Compositing. When it was clear the works was in trouble, Smith jumped ship and joined Catmull at ILM. Their first project here was the Genesis sequence in Star Trek II: The Wrath of Khan. Both Catmull and Smith came from a science background. I'm sure they're aware that while technical issues had ultimately doomed the works, it had also suffered from the fact it was being produced by researchers rather than filmmakers. In December of 1983, Catmull brought on animator John Lasseter, who had recently been fired from Disney, to assist them in creating their first computer animated narrative. And now, while we're going to be addressing some of the accomplishments of John Lasseter, I feel it's worth mentioning that in November 2017, he faced allegations of sexual misconduct towards employees. As we are living in a time where more and more media is tainted by this sort of behavior, I think it's important to note that film and animation are collaborative art forms, and his contribution and success would not have been possible without the work of many talented individuals, like L.V. Ray Smith, who in 1984 conceived and directed the adventures of André and Wally B. It is the simple story of a pestering bee, but its execution pushed the boundaries of what computer animation was capable of. It was revolutionary in its use of motion effects and 3D backgrounds, a look towards the future of animation very much rooted in the tradition of classic American cartoons. The short was a hit, and in 1986 the graphics group renamed themselves Pixar, breaking away from Lucasfilm with funding from Apple founder Steve Jobs. Under Jobs, they released a commercial version of their hardware system known as the Pixar Image Computer. Over the next few years, they produced a series of animated shorts intended to promote the Image Computer's capabilities. Though powerful, it would sell less than 300 units before the hardware department was sold off in 1990. However, one client who was very pleased with the purchase of the Image Computer was the Walt Disney Company. Their feature animation department utilized the hardware for its Computer Animation Production System, or CAPS, which allowed hand-drawn animation to be digitally inked and colored. 1990's The Rescuers Down Under was the first Disney feature entirely produced with this process, followed by Beauty and the Beast in 1991. Beauty and the Beast also made use of Cap's ability to blend hand-drawn and computer animation. The film's famous ballroom scene finds Belle and Beast dancing through a 3D environment. Disney executives were impressed with the sequence and decided to invest more resources into computer animation. Despite the financial struggle caused by the poor sales of the Image Computer, Steve Jobs agreed to finance Pixar's Tin Toy. The short was intended to showcase the RenderMan software, which allowed photorealistic 3D rendering and featured a baby interacting with a musical toy. The film ended up winning the Oscar for Best Animated Short, the first computer animated film to do so, and garnered attention from Disney. Disney approached Pixar with the possibility of producing a feature-length computer animated narrative, which had long been a goal of Catmull and Smith. After tense negotiations, they agreed to produce a film based off Tin Toy, entitled Toy Story. The plot and characters went through many changes, with the original version being so dark and mean-spirited that the production was even temporarily shut down. Production was restarted in February 1994, now with the story of two toys vying for the attention of their owner. The film featured the voice talents of Tom Hanks and Tim Allen as Polestar Cowboy Woody and astronaut Buzz Lightyear, who throughout the film go from rivals to the best of friends. Each shot passed through 8 different animation teams before going to a render farm of 117 computers running 24 hours a day. It took anywhere between 45 minutes and 30 hours to render a frame, translating to about 3 minutes of finished animation per week. The film was released on November 22, 1995 to universal praise. For all involved, Toy Story was a dream realized. It was a technical marvel and ushered in a new era of animation. During this period, computer animation became more and more integrated into filmmaking, with Toy Story representing the pinnacle of decades worth of work and innovation. Its success opened the floodgates, and the possibilities now seemed endless. I will leave links to relevant material down in the description. If you enjoyed this video, give us a thumbs up, and if you haven't, please subscribe, and be sure to check out the other videos in the series. We should be wrapping it up sometime in November, but with October here, you can expect all sorts of horror and Halloween-themed content, so stay tuned, and as always, thanks for watching.